I'm talking about now. Now all I can see is chaos and confusion and panic.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I really have to say that it's my privilege to be here this evening. And even if I give many, many talks in Finland and abroad, I have to say, to be very honest, that it was pretty difficult to prepare this keynote this evening to you. For one reason, there is so much things that I want to discuss with you. But I ended up with this title. I really want to share the thoughts in my head at the moment about the most valuable asset in security nowadays and especially in the future. Security is my passion. I have worked with security issues more than 20 years as an officer in the military, in a business life, and nowadays my other job is to be a professor of cybersecurity in Aalto University. And I can say that I am one of the best cybersecurity professors in Finland because we have only two of those. But more I think about what is happening in security, more I think about the evolution, which you are very well aware of, I have to say that my main question is that what will happen next? And I think one of the biggest challenges and problems at the same time in security nowadays is that we are concentrating too strongly what we have seen, what had been done, and what kind of capabilities have been used. But for us, as security professionals, I would say that is not enough. We should understand the development of the technology better, and we should see the future in the better way what we are doing at the moment. But I have to say that, of course, when we talk and think about future, it's very challenging. And one thing what I have learned in security in more than 20 years, I can't find right answers by myself. It's very hard. If I want to find good answers, I call to my friends. I create a community. I increase my interaction. And I think this is the main issue why it is so nice and to be privileged to be in this Obey. This, in a way, new kind of community, what we together has created it. Because one of the most important things in security is that it is always a team sport. It was 3.5 years ago, I was in Las Vegas in DEF CON. I think many of you have been in this world's largest hacker conference annually arranged in Las Vegas. And there was one event which I can remember the rest of my life. This guy, General Keith Alexander, who was the chief of the NSA and also the commander of the US Cyber Command, entered it to the stage and gave a keynote. There were thousands of talented hackers in that hall. And I have to say that it was a very remarkable moment when this general, chief of NSA and commander of the US Cyber Command, said that in this room here is the talent of our nation needs to secure cyberspace. He even mentioned that the security of the United States is in this room. And there was other thing what he said also, that if we had this kind of talented people what we have in that DEFCON conference at that moment, working together, we could solve many, many issues what are challenging at the moment. And I have to say, coming here this evening to disobey, to give a keynote to you, General Keith Alexander came into my mind. When I look at you, I see people working together, solving problems together. And in an ambitious way, I would say the future of the security of Finland is in this room tonight. And I would say also, using the same words from the General Keith Alexander, that if we work together, we can solve many, many problems which are very challenging at the moment. One thing what we pretty often forget when we talk about security, whatever definition you use, IT security, information security, digital security, cyber security, that's not important. We pretty often forget that the humans, us, we are the most valuable asset when we are talking about security. And the value of the talented people, you, is increasing at the moment in the whole world. For example, this guy, he is the successor of the General Keith Alexander. He is the Admiral Michael Rogers, who is nowadays the chief of the NSA and also the commander of the US Cyber Command. I could imagine that he is a very busy man. But even if he is very busy, he travels a lot nowadays around the United States, going to the universities, research institutes, etc., and give speeches to young people. Why? I think it's very easy to find the answer when you look at the cybersecurity strategy of the United States Department of the Defense. Strategic goal number one, major investment on cyber personnel to get the right people to work for you. That's why he is traveling and giving so many speeches in the United States. And I find this very interesting also, this report which was delivered to the President Obama last month, commissioned by the cybersecurity experts, giving suggestions to the president that what the United States have to do in order to be the best in cybersecurity in the whole world. One of the recommendations is that United States should train, believe it or not, 1,000 cybersecurity specialists within next few years. Very ambitious goal. But at the same time, really tells us how important the talented individuals, us as humans, are if we want to improve security. And of course, it's not the United States only. For example, in the Russia, like their defense minister Sergei Shoigu has said, there is ongoing a big headhunt to these talented security, cybersecurity professionals. And at the same time, Russia, like many other countries, they are creating new possibilities, for example, inside the military, to train these specialists. And we know that in some cases, for example, in Russia, an alternative to prison, these hackers has been provided it, not going to Siberia, but work for the intelligence services, because they need these good people. Or in France, very same thing. And I could continue this more or less long time ahead. It's the same issue in many, many countries at the moment. And of course, this is not about the military and the governments. It's the private companies who are on the very same pool, fighting on these talented individuals. And, for example, in the United States, when you look at, for example, the companies like Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola, General Motors, J.B. Morgan, and many, many other very big companies, what they have done during the last 2 years, they have hired cybersecurity specialists, even to be one of their board members in the very top management level in their companies. And many researches tell us that there will be in coming years, because everything is going to be more or less smart or digital, there is going to be a huge increase of the demand of the security specialists in this field. Numbers varies, but it has been said that, for example, this year, 1 million new job openings in this field. And I think that's a very huge number. And it's the very same thing in the companies. According to this research, the main problem or challenge with the security in IT field in companies nowadays is the lack of in-house expertises. There is not enough good people to solve these challenges. And of course, in Finland, we have the same thing. We have very ambitious objective in our national cybersecurity strategy. We want to be the forerunner in this field 2016, or maybe a little bit later. But what I have been doing very much during the last 6 months, Aalto University, together with Jyväskylän University, University of Jyväskylä, we have been doing the research, a report to the Prime Minister's office, where we are analyzing what is the current state in cybersecurity in Finland and what we should do in coming years. And we will deliver this report to the Prime Minister's office within next couple of weeks. And of course, I can't relieve too much of the conclusions of that report, but one thing I can share you. One of the biggest challenges in Finland, if we want to be the forerunners in this field, we need more expertise in this field. We need more people to work with these issues. But especially since we have already, you and many others, specialists in Finland, we need people to work together. And of course, there are many options for that. I think one good thing is that, for example, our military, they are following the time. There is already possibilities, for example, for the conscripts. If you have right skills, you can be a so-called cyber warrior also in the conscript service. Or there are also many other voluntary possibilities to share your knowledge, to increase your interaction with other professionals, and more or less, be on the right side. So even if there is a lot of discussion at the moment in the world, a little bit hyping also, about cyber arms race, I conclude that there is even fiercer arms race at the moment in cyber for talented individuals. Race for the good people. And this race, I predict, will be accelerating in coming years. But what kind of skills are needed? Many of you have very special skills. I see many familiar faces over there, and some of you I know pretty well. But I think one issue, whatever special technical skills you have, I would encourage you also better to understand at the same time the big picture. Be the strategic thinker also what is happening in this field. And that is one reason, for example, why my students in Aalto University, in their cybersecurity course, they read this book, Art of War by Sun Tzu, written approximately 2,000 years ago. Because many of these principles, what we are seeing at the moment, there is nothing new in them. It's the new environment, digital environment, but more or less the same principles are very valid even today. For example, we are seeing DDoS attacks to be used as diversion in order to get the focus away from the real attack. What the Sun Tzu wrote 2,000 years ago, all warfare is based on deception. We have new ways to do these things, but more or less many of the principles in the strategic way and our in strategic thinking are more or less the same. Few words concerning on so-called cyber war. Actually, there is no cyber war at all. I don't even like this phrase, so-called cyber war. I think the main issue, I recently wrote an article to the Newsweek, and I could summarize that a war that happens only in this digital world, in this cyber domain, is probably unlikely never to be happened. But at the same time, already, there is no a single war, conflict, or crisis in the world where there is no cyber element in it. And in coming years, this cyber warfare and the importance of it will be increasing. And it will be an element in all wars and crises. But I think it's important to understand that this is not a revolution of war. I call it evolution. We are living in the information societies nowadays, so I think it's very natural that war is being conducted also in the networks, in this digital domain. And from the strategic point of view, we have to understand that this digital domain changes also the other domains and the warfare of it in land, sea, air, and space. And asking the simple question, which is not simple to answer, I would even encourage you to think, what is so-called war in 2017? How much violence has to be used in order to achieve your political goals? I think that is a very relevant question at the moment, both in the practical world and also from the theoretical point of view in the academics. And this is getting more and more strategic, like in the NATO last summer in their summit in Warsaw. They decided it politically that this digital domain is as important than other domains, land, sea, air, and space. And a severe cyber attack, so-called cyber attack, can trigger the Article 5 of the NATO, the common defense. And I see that the whole world at the moment is moving towards a greater strategic use of these capabilities, what we are having. But how we really know how good or weak some nations or some non-nation state actors really are in digital domain? I think that is one of the most challenging and tempting questions at the moment. because these kind of capabilities are not presented in the military parades. You can't see hackers in the military parades or other so-called cyber capabilities. No one really knows how good or what kind of capabilities countries really possess in this digital domain. But what we know and what we have seen, I could summarize that the states are ready, already 2017, today, testing the boundaries of this digital battlefield. Battlefield, which we in Finland more and more call this so-called hybrid warfare or hybrid environment where we are living. And I would say that when we are talking about cyber operations, they fit very well to this hybrid environment for five reasons. First of all, as you very well know, and we have many, many practical examples, attribution is challenging, probably not impossible, but always very challenging, especially from the political point of view. Second of all, I think one reason why the nation states are very active in cyber domain is that there is very little political risks for their actions. In politics, these kind of questions are in the very early stage. And same concerns the international law. How international law can really follow the development of these capabilities, this development of the technology? The short answer is, it's not following. It's pretty much behind. The fourth point is, what we are seeing, I am working in many international working groups, and one point what we have been seeing that has been increasing during last few years is that nation states are more and more outsourcing their cyber activities to non-state actors, meaning proxy groups or some criminal groups who are getting resources or objectives for the operations from the government, but they are actually doing the dirty work. And if they get caught, then of course the government will say that we have nothing to do with these groups. We are talking about deniability. And this is challenging and increasing, as well as the value of so-called non-kinetic assets. At the same time, I think it's the human mind that we like to separate things like a black and white or other dichotomies, what we usually have in our head. But when I'm thinking about security of today, and especially in the future, many of these dichotomies which we are trying to organize our minds to see the world or environment, they are blurring. What is war? What is peace? Our side, their side, beginning, end, win, lose. And I have noticed that it is even harder also to separate security from insecurity. And I think one of the trends in security, when we are thinking about it in coming years, is that these dichotomies are blurring even more. And in this so-called battle, and I think this is very important, even if it's very simplified phrase, every one of us is in the front line. Every one of us. And I think that is one reason why I would really like to encourage you all to share your knowledge outside of yourself or your own group. I think this was very good examples a few days ago when some of you collected it to the main principles for us all Finns that, okay, these are 5 tips that we want to give you. Follow these and you will be more secured. Very simple thing, but what I have heard and discussed with many people after releasing this news, many people have been very happy for disobey, for these people to share this knowledge with other people, with other Finns. And I think one, my message to you is that I really hope when you have this knowledge, you share it and you increase the understanding of these issues to the whole society, even the whole world. Don't keep this information by yourself. That's very important when we are talking about the future of the security. And one thing, of course, what we are discussing in Finland, like President Niinistö this morning in the television, and especially in the internationally, and this is something what we will be discussing and hearing a lot during this year, is the election security. Like we all have followed what has probably happened in the United States and in the presidential elections. And I think it's very interesting to read this report, which was released last Friday by the intelligence community of the United States, very officially accusing Russia of interfering their presidential elections. And using many simple means to do that. Like I mentioned to you earlier, many of these issues what we are talking about, I think you hear it and you understand that these are very simple issues. And pretty often they are. For example, how we really increase the understanding of the sphere phishing in Finland, that we are not facing these kind of things, which are mentioned in this report. And of course, there's a lot of discussion at the moment in the Europe. Strong messages, for example, this week from the Prime Minister of the Sweden or Angela Merkel in the Germany, worrying about the security of the elections which are happening in Europe this year. And at the same time, not only talking about the breaches or leaks, we are talking more and more about the information influence, and there are many dimensions of that one. I think the biggest so-called cyber battles will be forth for our thoughts, for our understanding, for our values in information societies. And that is one reason why I really would like to encourage you to share your thoughts, share your expertise, to work together. Because when we are talking about the threats, for example, concerning on the elections, coming from the nation states, I think it's reasonable to say that we are moving more and more from knowns to unknowns. And one of the challenges is that we concentrate too much, officially I mean, what we know, what we observe, and what we have seen, what has happened. I really would like you to work with us, to work with me, hopefully, to think more about the methods, more about the issues which we have not seen yet, which have not been used yet, or even, which seems to be pretty impossible to think of. This is something what in many working groups nowadays we are discussing. What is the digital domain and to utilizing it in phase 2.0? And we are talking about, for example, more and more on data manipulation, so-called identity murders, dirty campaigns used by the automated using artificial intelligence, and more and more. When we think about the future, I think we have to be able to be more innovative what we are nowadays. That is crucial. And think even impossible what is happening. What do you think? Could this be possible in near future? We don't elect any more president which is human. For example, probably not in our presidential elections in Finland next year. But maybe someday we will see the debates where there is an artificial intelligence or a robot participating in these debates. Well, if that is a good one, I would say that a good robot with good intelligence could work for 24/7. Probably the robots, they don't have any sex scandals. Like maybe there are some other candidates. This seems to be pretty impossible to think nowadays. And of course, it's very hard to say, will this ever happen? But anyway, I foresee and I believe that in this obey, after 10 years, 2027, we are not laughing anymore for these kind of ideas. Because we don't fully understand in Finland or in Europe, for example, what kind of emphasis these issues has in the most powerful nation when we are talking about the cyber at the moment, and I talk about the United States. That's why I want to show you shortly this report, which appears or is being published once a year. It's a report by intelligence services of the United States, all 17 of them. And they are openly saying that what are the main threats against the United States. And the last report, there was nothing new. It was the third year in a row that they were talking about the cyber threats. The new thing was, on page one in this report, was that they were talking about the cyber and technology. And think about it. Report from the United States intelligence community, published once a year, page one, chapter two, they are talking about the Internet of Things. Not about Putin, not about ISIS, not about the nuclear weapons. Internet of Things. And chapter three, artificial intelligence. Page one. And of course, we don't know what will happen in the United States concerning about these issues, what we are thinking in disobey. I collected some phrases from the Donald Trump, how he see these things. Of course, we don't fully know what he will actually do. But I think also these words, what he has been saying, describes very well where the United States, one of the most powerful nations in this field, will be heading in his presidential term. My last point, when I'm thinking about the future and working together, I have to say that the more I personally think about the future, think about the technology, the development of it, and think about working with a lot with the future specialists, I think in next 30 years, humankind, us, may change more than we have changed during last 300 years. And we are not anymore from this situation that we are not anymore talking soon what the machines or what the computers, what the software, what they can do, but what we are letting them to do. I'm talking about the digital ethics. I'm talking about the humanity 2.0. And I really hope that these kind of discussions or considerations are not only being done by some small research groups or some groups of professors in the universities. No. These kind of issues are something that I really ask you to take part in. For example, we are already seeing these kind of small drones which are flying in the air, which can identify who is the person. It can identify what kind of weapons this person is holding. And already, in some cases, this is the video from the Army of the United States, the drone itself has the ability to make the decision to kill that human being. A drone has that decision already. So this is not so much anymore about the future. And of course, this is not only about the military. When we are thinking about the technology overlapping more or less everything we do in our societies, in our businesses, in our daily lives, these are the questions that concerns more or less every one of us, and even more in coming years. And that is reason I would like to emphasize you to take part in these discussions of the humanity 2.0. And I have also noticed that even if I'm working very closely with the technology and security, I have to understand more about the human sciences. And I think the value for the hackers, for the technical specialists and so on, the value of the understanding of the human sciences will be increasing, hopefully. Because in science, half of we know is wrong. But our purpose is to know or determine which half is right and which half is wrong. Because I personally, I have 3 kids, 2 dogs, 1 wife. I really believe that the future is in our hands. And when I'm talking about the future security, I'm talking about more and more about the skills, the expertise, the professionalism, what we have in this room. And as you very well know, we are having a big celebration in Finland this year. We are celebrating our 100-year independence, which is great. Yeah. And I really like the main theme summarized with one word, how we are celebrating our independence. That is yhdessä, together. And if I have to summarize what I really want to say to you after speaking more than 40 minutes, I would summarize it with this same, very same word. together. Thank you very much. Thank you. Any questions, comments, opinions? There will be a microphone coming.
Thank you for the presentation. I'm a bit concerned that we might be sending a mixed message here. I'm concerned about the militarization of the our scene. For example, during the last 2 days, we have been seeing presentations mentioning ISIS many times, order loop, military thinking, military strategy, and so on. Mm-hmm. So what's your personal opinion? We have a room full of people. Should they be preparing to make our society better by creating better operating system, better browsers, and so on, or should they be preparing to wage war?
I don't like if everything is going to be militarized, not at all. But I am also having a very strong opinion that when we want to defend our nation, we have to do it in land, sea, and air, and more in this cyber domain nowadays. And I think one of the key points in Finland is that we have this comprehensive security approach. We have had it since the Second World War, where we are emphasizing that we want to do the things together. Our public service, our businesses, our organizations, even individual Finns. And I really support this kind of comprehensive approach to create Finland security better, also in this cyber field.
Yeah, I agree. Actually, I really like your point about the blurring between the war and peace.
Dichotomies, yes.
Yeah. And in the public discussion, it's sort of sad that the mindset of people who are young and creative, they are starting to live in the state of terror, in a sense. That's something that has to be discussed in the society.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you very much. And that is the one of the reasons why I wanted to emphasize that even if, when you are having extremely good technological skills, for example, in some specific area, I really like to see, and us all, to have the better strategic understanding of this big picture, what is happening. For example, I was earlier today having very good discussions in Tieteen Päivät, which is happening in Helsinki at the moment. And we were talking about this and trying to answer this very simple question. What is security? How you define it? How you measure security? Or how much security is nowadays equivalent to the resilience if everything is going to be broken, if we can't secure our systems? And what I have learned also is that many times these very simple questions, they are the hardest one to answer.
Yeah, you said that there was press that the Swedish elections were affected, in their opinion. And I mean, we are closer.
I think it was a very strong message by the Prime Minister about 1 week ago, when he was saying that he is very, very worrying about the security of the Swedish elections. And these same messages during the last 2 weeks, we have been hearing from Angela Merkel, we have been hearing from the head of the intelligence services in Germany, Hans-Georg Maassen, we have heard from the France and many other countries. And I think that, like I mentioned, election security will be a big discussion topic in Europe this year.
Okay, one last thing. Well, this is a simple one. Are you concerned? Because I am. Are you concerned about the influence in Finland?
Short answer, yes.
Thank you.
Yksi vielä.
The question kind of continues the previous question. Do you have any real life recent examples which show that Finland is well prepared to responding to cyber attack, or maybe not sufficiently prepared?
In our report, which I mentioned that we are writing at the moment, we end up to the conclusion that Finland is not the best one in this field in the whole world. I think that's no surprise. But we are pretty good at the same time when we look at these different areas, how security is being credited in this digital field in Finland. And in general, I have to say that I would say, comparing to many, many other countries, I say that Finland is pretty prepared for different kind of cyber hostilities. But one of the challenges is that this whole environment is developing so fast. How we keep up our defenses, how we keep up people thinking to follow this development, that's pretty challenging. And I think, like I mentioned, that in coming years, when we talk about security, we will be talking about more the resilience, our ability to withstand different kind of disruption situation. Not only in the physically, but especially mentally. Talking about the mental resilience, I think that will be one of the key issues in security in Finland in the coming years. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.